prostrating at the lotus feet of Brahmanishtha Sadguru, Swami Virajeshwara Saraswati, and the entire Guru Parampara on behalf of all of us. Today's discourse on Viveka Chudamani will continue. Om Sri Ganeshaya Namaha. Om Sri Mahasaraswatyai Namaha. Sadashiva Samarambham Sri Shankaracharya Madhyamam Asmadacharya Pariyantam Vande Guru Paramparam Shruti Smruti Purana Malayam Karunalayam Namami Bhagavat Padam Shankaram Loka Shankaram Shankaram Shankaracharyam Keshavam Badarayanam Sutra Bhashya Krutau Vande Bhagavantau Punah Punah Sarva Vedanta Siddhanta Gocharam Tamagocharam Govindam Paramanandam Sadgurum Pranatosmiham Om Namo Bhagavate Virajeshwaraya Harihi Om. Last time we had stopped at the shloka number 307. So from 308 time, we will commence today the discourse. In these shlokas, ultimately what we have to remember is Acharya is trying to impress upon the disciple who is a jijnyasu mumukshu uttam adhikari, who is on the path of spiritual sadhana, to know his own reality. Who am I? See that question, that burning desire. So the mumukshu is ready for atmasakshatkar. So to prepare the mumukshu, that Brahma Vidya, that supreme knowledge, Acharya Shankara Bhagavatpada is giving out in the form of his beautiful discourses, in the form of a dialogue between the Shishya and the Guru. Now in the last set of shlokas, and now for the next two or three couple more shlokas, here repeatedly, Acharya is emphasizing on the point of negation of ahankara, negation of ego, that I am the body, that individuality, swabhimana. In other words, the sharirabhimana. See, this ahankara, thinking that I am the body-mind complex, I am this individual with a name and a status. So this feeling, inborn feeling, instinctive feeling is called ego or ahankara. So Acharya is trying to see that. He is trying to negate, he is trying to emphasize to the disciple, his beloved disciple, that this is the greatest enemy. This ahankara, this feeling is the greatest enemy in the path of realization. So this has completely covered adhyaroha or anatma, and it is showing itself as the Atman itself. So this is a pseudo I, this outer I, that I am so and so. This outer feeling of individuality, it has to be removed, without which realization is impossible to achieve. So that is a point. This is the substance of all these shlokas. It's called negation of ahankara, negation of ego factor. ಈ ಶ್ಲೋಕಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಅಹಂಕಾರದ ನಿಂದನೆಯನ್ನು ಆಚಾರ್ಯರು ಪದೇ ಪದೇ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ ಶಿಷ್ಯನಿಗೆ ಅರ್ಥ ಆಗಲಿ. ಎಲ್ಲಿಯವರೆಗೆ ಶರೀರಾಭಿಮಾನ, ಈ ದೇಹಾಭಿಮಾನ ಇದೆಯೋ ಅಲ್ಲಿಯವರೆಗೆ ಮೋಕ್ಷ ಪ್ರಾಪ್ತಿ ಇಲ್ಲಪ್ಪ, ಸ್ವರೂಪ ಜ್ಞಾನ ಬರೋದಿಲ್ಲಪ್ಪ, ಆತ್ಮಜ್ಞಾನ ಉಂಟಾಗೋದೇ ಇಲ್ಲ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳ್ತಾರೆ. ಬೇರೆ ಬೇರೆ ಉದಾಹರಣೆ ಯಾವ ಮಟ್ಟದಲ್ಲಿ ಹೇಳ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ ಆಚಾರ್ಯರು ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಮುಂದಿನ ಶ್ಲೋಕದಲ್ಲಿ ಸಮೂಲ ಕೃತ್ತೋಪಿ ಮಹಾನಹಂ ಪುನಃ ಯುಲ್ಲೇಖಿತ ಸ್ಯಾತ್ ಯದಿ ಚೇತಸಾ ಕ್ಷಣಂ संजीव्य विक्षेप शतम करोति नभस्वता प्रावृषि वारिदो यथा समूलकृतोपि महानहं पुनः युल्लेखितः स्यात् यदि चेतसा क्षणम् संजीव्य विक्षेप शतम करोति नभस्वता प्रावृषि वारिदो यथा. With an example, he is explaining that ಈ ಶ್ಲೋಕದಲ್ಲಿ ಆಚಾರ್ಯರು ಬಹಳ ಹೇಳ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ. ಏನು ಹೇಳ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ ಅಂದರೆ, ಈ ಅಹಂಕಾರ ಎಷ್ಟು ಬಲಿಷ್ಠವಾಗಿದೆ, ನಾನು ಅನ್ನೋ ನಾನು ಅನ್ನೋ ಭಾವ, ಇದನ್ನು ಪೂರ್ತಿಯಾಗಿ ಕಿತ್ತು ಹಾಕಿದ್ರೂ ಸಹ ಅನುಷ್ಠಾನದಿಂದ, ಶ್ರವಣ ಮನನ ನಿಧಿಧ್ಯಾಸನದಿಂದ, ಗುರುವಿನಿಂದ ಆದೇಶಿತನಾಗಿ ಸಾಧನೆ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಅಹಂಕಾರವನ್ನು ಸಂಪೂರ್ಣವಾಗಿ ಕಿತ್ತು ಹಾಕಿದ್ರೂ ಸಹ, ಅಥವಾ ಕಿತ್ತು ಹಾಕಿದ್ದೇನೆ ನನ್ನ ಅಹಂಕಾರವನ್ನು ಅಂತ ತಿಳ್ಕೊಂಡ್ರೂ ಸಹ, ಒಂದು ಕ್ಷಣ ಇದನ್ನು ನಾನು ನಾನು ಅಂತ ಸ್ಮರಿಸ್ಕೊಂಡು ಬಿಟ್ರೆ, ಅದು ಮನಸ್ಸಿಗೆ ನಾನು ಅನ್ನೋ ಭಾವ ಬಂದುಬಿಟ್ರೆ, ಈ ಮಳೆಗಾಲದಲ್ಲಿ ಯಾವ ರೀತಿ ಈ ಮೋಡಗಳು ಅವುಗಳನ್ನ ಗಾಳಿ ಜೋರಾಗಿ ಬೀಸಿದಾಗ ಅವು ಚದರಿ ಯಾವ ರೀತಿ ಮಳೆ ಸುರಿಸುತ್ತಲ್ಲ, ಆ ಪ್ರಕಾರ ಈ ಮೇಘಗಳು ಗಾಳಿಯ ಪ್ರಭಾವದಿಂದ ಯಾವ ರೀತಿ ಮಳೆಯನ್ನು ಸುರಿಸುತ್ತೋ ಆ ರೀತಿ, ಒಂದು ಕ್ಷಣಕಾಲ ಅಹಂಕಾರವನ್ನು ಸ್ಮರಿಸಿದರೆ ಅದು ನಮ್ಮ ಅಧ್ಯಾತ್ಮ ಜೀವನದಲ್ಲಿ ಈ ಸಾಧನಾ ಮಾರ್ಗದಲ್ಲಿ ಒಂದು ದೊಡ್ಡ ಅಡ್ಡಿಯಾಗುತ್ತದೆ. ಮನಸ್ಸಿನಲ್ಲಿ ನೂರಾರು ವೃತ್ತಿಗಳನ್ನ ವಿಕ್ಷೇಪಗಳನ್ನ ಹುಟ್ಟಾಕುತ್ತದೆ ಅಂತ ಆಚಾರ್ಯ. ಸೊ ಇನ್ ದಿಸ್ ಶ್ಲೋಕ ವಾಟ್ ಆಚಾರ್ಯ ಇಸ್ ಸೇಯಿಂಗ್ ದಟ್ ಈವನ್ ಎ ಡಿಸೈಪಲ್ ಹೂ ಇಸ್ ಡೂಯಿಂಗ್ ಸಿನ್ಸಿಯರ್ ಸಾಧನ, ಹೂ ಇಸ್ ಎ ಕ್ವಾಲಿಫೈಡ್ ಡಿಸೈಪಲ್, ಹೂ ಇಸ್ ಎ ಉತ್ತಮ ಅಧಿಕಾರಿ ಲೈಕ್ ಯು, ಲುಕ್ ಮೈ ಡಿಯರ್ ಡಿಸೈಪಲ್, ಈವನ್ ಇಫ್ ಯು ಥಿಂಕ್ ದಟ್ ಯು ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ರಿಮೂವ್ ದಿಸ್ ಅಹಂಕಾರ, ದಿಸ್ ಈಗೋ ಫ್ಯಾಕ್ಟರ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ಯುವರ್ ಮೈಂಡ್, ಯು ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಐಡೆಂಟಿಫೈಡ್ ದಟ್ ಬಾಡಿ ಮೈಂಡ್ ಕಾಂಪ್ಲೆಕ್ಸ್ ಈಸ್ ನಾಟ್ ರಿಯಲಿ ಯು, ಸೊ ಈವನ್ ಇಫ್ ಯು ರಿಮೂವ್ ದಿ ಅಹಂಕಾರ ಟೋಟಲಿ it is so powerful that even for a fraction of a second, if you just remember it, if you just remember it for a moment, it will again reappear. It will again reappear. Its ego gets awakened. The moment you say I, the moment you remember your ego, it will come back. It will come back. It will capture you. And it will create hundreds of perplexities, vikshepas, doubts and desires and actions in your mind. It is something like during the rainy season, navasvata pravrishi varido yatha sanjeevya vikshepa shatam karoti. Acharya is giving example. In the rainy season, when all the clouds, water-bearing clouds are connected in one place, when a wind blows with ferocity, all that water-bearing clouds in the rainy season will scatter here and there, helter and skelter, and start, you know, the cloud burst, that is nowadays the word they use. Suddenly they start, you know, heavy downpour in a particular area. Like that. It is like that. It is like that. So, if you remember, even for a second, the ego will regenerate, rejuvenate in your mind, and it will capture you. It will completely capture you. You are back to square one. That is what Acharya is talking here. Nigrushya shatro ahamo vakashaha kvachinna deyo vishayanu chintaya. ಸಯೇವ ಸಂಜೀವನ ಹೇತುವಸ್ಯ ಪ್ರಕ್ಷೀಣ ಜಂಬೀರ ತರೋರಿವಾಂಬು ನಿಗೃಹ್ಯ ಶತ್ರೋ ಅಹಮೋ ಅವಕಾಶ ಕ್ವಚಿತ್ ನ ದೇಯೋ ವಿಷಯಾನು ಚಿಂತಯ ಸಯೇವ ಸಂಜೀವನ ಹೇತುರಸ್ಯ ಪ್ರಕ್ಷೀಣ ಜಂಬೀರ ತರೋರಿವಾಂಬು. ನೌ ಇನ್ ದ ನೆಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ ಶ್ಲೋಕ ಮತ್ತೆ ಒಂದು ಉದಾಹರಣೆ ಕೊಡ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ ಆಚಾರ್ಯ. ಈ ಭಯಂಕರ ಶತ್ರುವಾದಂತಹ ಅಹಂಕಾರವನ್ನ ಪೂರ್ತಿಯಾಗಿ ತೆಗೆದು ಹಾಕಿದ್ರೂ ಸಹ, ಅದನ್ನ ನಿಗ್ರಹಗೊಳಿಸಿದ್ರೂ ಸಹ, ಯಾವುದೇ ಕಾರಣಕ್ಕೆ ವಿಷಯ ಚಿಂತನೆಗಳನ್ನು ಮನಸ್ಸಿಗೆ ತರಬಾರದು. ಒಂದು ವೇಳೆ ವಿಷಯ ಚಿಂತನೆಗಳು ಬಂದರೆ ಮನಸ್ಸಿನಲ್ಲಿ, ಅವಾಗ ಏನಾಗುತ್ತೆ ಅಂದರೆ, ಒಣಗಿ ಹೋಗಿರ್ತಕ್ಕಂತಹ ನಿಂಬೆಯ ಗಿಡಕ್ಕೆ ನೀರು ಹಾಕಿದಾಗ ಯಾವ ರೀತಿಯ ಗಿಡ ಮತ್ತೆ ಚಿಗಿದುಕೊಂಡು ಎಲೆಗಳನ್ನು ಬಿಡುತ್ತೋ, ಒಣಗಿ ಹೋಗಿರೋ ಗಿಡ ಮತ್ತೆ ಜೀವ ಪಡೆಯುತ್ತದೋ, ಹಾಗೆ ವಿಷಯ ಚಿಂತನೆಗಳಿಂದ ನಿಗ್ರಹಿಸಲ್ಪಟ್ಟ ಅಹಂಕಾರ ಮತ್ತೆ ಮತ್ತೆ ಮನಸ್ಸಲ್ಲಿ ಗರಿಗೆದರುತ್ತದೆ. ನಾನು 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 ವಿಷಯ ಚಿಂತನೆ, ಮನಸ್ಸು ಅಂದರೆ ಕಾಮದ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಓಡ್ತಾ ಇರುತ್ತೆ, ಎಲ್ಲ ರೀತಿಯ ಬಯಕೆಗಳು, ಆಸೆಗಳು, ಅದು ಬಂದುಬಿಡ್ತು ಅಂದರೆ ಮತ್ತೆ ಅಹಂಕಾರ ಉದಯ ಆಯಿತು ಅಂತ. ಸೊ ವಾಟ್ ಆಚಾರ್ಯ ಅಗೇನ್ ಈ ಗಿವ್ಸ್ ಎಕ್ಸಾಂಪಲ್ ಹಿಯರ್, ದಿ ಎಕ್ಸಾಂಪಲ್ ಈಸ್ ಸಏವ ಸಂಜೀವನ ಹೇತುರಸ್ಯ ಪ್ರಕ್ಷೀಣ ಜಂಬೀರ ತರೋ ಇವ ಅಂಬು. ಪ್ರಕ್ಷೀಣ ಜಂಬೀರ ತರೋ ಇವ ಅಂಬು, ಅಂಬು ಇವ ಸಏವ ಸಂಜೀವನ ಹೇತು ಅಸ್ಯ. ವೆನ್ ಎ ಟೋಟಲಿ ಡ್ರೈಡ್ ಅಪ್ ಲೈಮ್ ಟ್ರೀ, ಎ ಲೆಮನ್ ಪ್ಲಾಂಟ್ ಇನ್ ಯುವರ್ ಕೋರ್ಟ್ ಯಾರ್ಡ್, ಇಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಡ್ರೈಡ್, leaves are dried because of lack of water. And on such an occasion, if you start, you know, pouring water to the such dried up lime tree, which has still life in it, then within no time, within a day, you know, it will once again, you know, get into back to the life, and new leaves will be sprouting, and the lime tree will once again come back to life. By adding water, by pouring water. Just like that. Vishayanu chintaya kvachit avakashana deyaha, Acharya says. So, Vishayanu chintaya, the thoughts, the desires, the thoughts of sense objects, the thoughts arising in the mind towards possessing something, such thoughts, vishayanu chinta, chintaya, such thoughts, such desires, even if, you know, they come out in your mind, even after vanquishing ego, the ego will once again come back. Ego will come back once again because of vishaya chintaya, thinking of the sense objects. When a small desire erupts in the mind, it will lead to your actions, other desires. You want to fulfill one desire, then another desire. So mind will go, and then ego also will expand. So the dried up ego will once again come back to life by thinking sense objects, by developing desires in the mind. That is the point here Acharya is talking here. So why Acharya is giving this example? Because the small doubt may come into the mind of a mumukshu or a jijnasu, that if the ego is destroyed, how it will sprout back? How it will come back? If it is really destroyed. So far, that doubt, thinking that such a doubt may arise, Acharya is giving this shloka, the answer in this shloka. Even though the ego has been removed, we think like that, but it will come back. It will come back. The moment you start thinking on sense objects, the moment desires will enter our mind, I want this, I want that. I want to do this, I want to do that. So when such desires, Vishaya, Chintaya, when such desires, Vishayanu Chintaya, when thinking about obtaining something, possessing something, want to have something, some sense objects, where so that your sense perception, you know, get fully satisfied. So the feeling of possessing something, getting something, acquiring something, so doing some action, all these things will see to it that your vanquished ego will once again sprout back. Once again, it will get the new life, new lease of life, and it will once again cover you, cover your original reality. So, what actually Acharya is talking here is, you should not yield to such Vishayanu Chintaya. You should not yield to such desires. As the desires start sprouting, you should cut them, nip, you know, what we call, nip in the bud. That phrase is used in English. Vishayagala chintane, vishaya sukhada bagge bayake, aasegalu, hutto samayadalle avugalanna chivutu haakta irbeku anta helta idare aacharya. Avana belilik bidabardu manasinalli. ಅವು ಇರೋದ್ರಿಂದ ಮತ್ತೆ ಮತ್ತೆ ಅಹಂಕಾರ ಉತ್ಪತ್ತಿ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ. ಅಹಂಕಾರ ಬಿಟ್ಟಿದ್ದೇನೆ ಅಂತ ಅನ್ಕೊಂಡ್ರು ಸಹ ಮತ್ತೆ ನಾನು ನಾನು ಅನ್ನೋ ಅಹಂಕಾರ ಬಂದ್ಬಿಡುತ್ತೆ. ವಿಷಯಾನು ಚಿಂತನೆಯಿಂದ, ವಿಷಯ ಸುಖಗಳ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಮನಸ್ಸು ಓಡೋದ್ರಿಂದ ಬಂದ್ಬಿಡುತ್ತೆ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳ್ತಾರೆ ಆಚಾರ್ಯರು. ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಏನ್ ಹೇಳ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ, ಭಗವದ್ಗೀತೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಪರಮಾತ್ಮ ಇದನ್ನು ಬಹಳ ವಿಷದವಾಗಿ, ಸುಲಲಿತವಾಗಿ, ತರ್ಕಬದ್ಧವಾಗಿ ಹೇಳಿಬಿಟ್ಟಿದ್ದಾನೆ. ಇದೇ 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 ಇಲ್ಲಿರ್ತಕ್ಕಂತಹ ವಿಷಯವನ್ನೇ ಭಗವಂತ ಭಗವದ್ಗೀತೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಹೇಳಿಬಿಟ್ಟಿದ್ದಾನಲ್ಲ. ಭಗವಂತ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಹೇಳಿದ್ದನ್ನ ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಸಂಕ್ಷೇಪವಾಗಿ ಹೇಳ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ ಆಚಾರ್ಯರು. ಮುಂದೆ ಮುಂದೆ ಇನ್ನು ಕೆಲವು ಶ್ಲೋಕಗಳಾದ ಮೇಲೆ, 320-324 ಶ್ಲೋಕ ದಾಟಿದ ಮೇಲೆ, ಭಗವದ್ಗೀತೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಪರಮಾತ್ಮ ಕೃಷ್ಣ ಪರಮಾತ್ಮ ಏನು ಹೇಳಿದ್ದಾನೋ ಅದನ್ನೇ ಮತ್ತೆ ಇವರು ತಮ್ಮ ಸುಲಭವಾದ ಶ್ಲೋಕಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಮತ್ತೆ ಮತ್ತೆ ಹೇಳ್ತಾರೆ. ಮುಂದೆ ಭಗವದ್ಗೀತೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಭಗವಂತ ಏನು ಹೇಳಿದ್ದಾರೆ 2nd chapter ಅಂದರೆ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಎರಡು ಶ್ಲೋಕ ಒಟ್ಟಿಗೆ ಹೋಗುತ್ತೆ. ಏನು ಧ್ಯಾಯತೋ ವಿಷಯಾನ್ ಪುಂಸಃ ಸಂಗಸ್ತೇಷೋಪಜಾಯತೆ ಸಂಗಾತ್ ಸಂಜಾಯತೆ ಕಾಮಃ ಕಾಮಾತ್ ಕ್ರೋಧೋ ಬಿಜಾಯತೆ ಕ್ರೋಧಾತ್ ಭವತಿ ಸಮ್ಮೋಹಃ ಸಮ್ಮೋಹಾತ್ ಸ್ಮೃತಿ ವಿಭ್ರಮಃ ಸ್ಮೃತಿ ಭ್ರಮಾತ್ ಬುದ್ಧಿನಾಶೋ ಬುದ್ಧಿನಾಶಾತ್ ಪ್ರಣಶ್ಯತಿ. ಲಾರ್ಡ್, ಇನ್ ದ ಟೂ ಶ್ಲೋಕಾಸ್ ಇನ್ ಭಗವದ್ಗೀತಾ ಸೆಕೆಂಡ್ ಚಾಪ್ಟರ್ ಎಂಡ್ಸ್ ದ ಸೆಕೆಂಡ್ ಶ್ಲೋಕ ಆಸ್ ಬುದ್ಧಿನಾಶಾತ್ ಪ್ರಣಶ್ಯತಿ. ಹಿಯರ್ ದಿ ಪರ್ಸನ್ ಈಸ್ ಡಿಸ್ಟ್ರಾಯ್ಡ್ ಬಿಕಾಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಇಸ್ intellect is totally clouded, deluded by delusion. He will be destroyed, means destroyed. Pranashyati means spiritually he will never be elevated or uplifted in this lifetime. He is born, he will live like any other individual or animal. He will enjoy his prarabdha or suffer whatever it is, and then he will die and take another birth. That's all. So, there is no question of spiritual upliftment here at all. Lord says in Gita. And logically he puts the question, you know, points here. Dhyayato vishayan pumsaha sangaste shupajayate. Sangaste shupajayate. So, the moment you start thinking, the moment the desires will start coming, you get associated. Sangasteshu upajaya. You get associated with the desire. Suddenly something comes in the mind. You want to possess something. So you get attached to that feeling at all. So you become attached to the feeling, that desire. Then sangat sanjayate kamaha. So by the attachment with the desire, what happens? the further urge, kamaha, urge to possess that, to fulfill your act, the mental satisfaction. So the kamaha, that urge will develop fast. Then kamat krodho vijayati. Once you don't get what you desire, then you become angry. You become angry because you want to possess, you want to do a particular thing today. You want to have a particular thing accomplished today. It won't happen. Then you become angry. You become angry. Krodhat bhavati sammoha. Then you become deluded. See, when the mind and the intellect becomes clouded with anger, you become deluded. Delusion. Sammoha. Bhranti. Bhrantasthiti. Vibhrantasthiti. You lose the sense of balance in the mind. You become agitated, emotional, because of anger. You wanted a particular thing to happen. Today it has not happened according to you, according to your will. So you become so emotionally agitated. You become so much angry, so much depressed. So that way you become totally, you come under the delusion, the spell of illusion at all, delusion at all, vibhrantasthiti. Mind becomes clouded. You lose the proper thinking mechanism in the life itself at that moment. Because you are so obsessed about the desire which is unfulfilled. Yavado ondu aase namage puraike aagtiddaga eshtu kova barutte, talamana barutte, udvega barutte, adarinda manasu kettu hogutte, manasu vibhrantagolluttade, sammohagolluttade ant helta iddane Bhagavanta. ಒಂದರಿಂದ ಒಂದು ಸಮೋಹ ಸ್ಮೃತಿ ವಿಭ್ರಮ ಸ್ಮೃತಿ ಭ್ರಮಾತ್ ಬುದ್ಧಿನಾಶೋ ಬುದ್ಧಿನಾಶಾತ್ ಪ್ರಣಶ. ಇದರಿಂದ ಏನಾಗುತ್ತೆ ಮುಂದೆ? ಮತಿಭ್ರಮಣೆಯಿಂದ ಬುದ್ಧಿನಾಶ ಆಗ್ತಾ ಹೋಯ್ತು. ಮುಂದೆ ಏನು ಮಾಡ್ಲಿಕ್ಕೂ ಮನಸ್ಸಾಗ್ತಾ ಇಲ್ಲ. ಮನಸ್ಸು ಅಲ್ಲೇ ಓಡ್ತಾ ಇದೆ. ಯಾವುದೋ ಒಂದು ಆಸೆ ಆ ಪೂರೈಕೆ ಆಗ್ತಾ ಇಲ್ಲ ಅಂತ ಮನಸ್ಸು ಅಲ್ಲೇ ಓಡ್ತಾ ಇದೆಯಲ್ಲ. ಅದರ ಜೊತೆಗೆ ಮತ್ತೆ ಮತ್ತೆ ಹೊಸ ಹೊಸ ಕೆಲವು ಆಸೆಗಳು ಸೇರ್ಕೊಳ್ತಾ ಹೋಗುತ್ತಲ್ಲ. ಅದು ಇದು ಪೂರೈಕೆ ಆಗ್ತಾ ಇಲ್ಲ, ಅದು ಆಗ್ತಾ ಇಲ್ಲ, ಇದು ಆಗ್ತಾ ಇಲ್ಲ. ಬರೀ ಮನಸ್ಸು ಆಸೆಗಳ ಮೂಟೆ ಹೊತ್ಕೊಂಡು ಗೊಂದಲ ಗೂಡಾಗಿ ತಿರುಗ್ತಾ ಇದೆಯಲ್ಲ. ಅದ್ರ ಬುದ್ಧಿ ನಾಶ ಆಯ್ತಲ್ಲ ಆ ವ್ಯಕ್ತಿ ಬುದ್ಧಿ. ಆ ಬುದ್ಧಿ ನಾಶ ಆದ್ಮೇಲೆ ಆ ವ್ಯಕ್ತಿ ಏನಾಗುತ್ತೆ? ಬುದ್ಧಿ ನಾಶ ಪ್ರಣಶ್ಯತಿ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದಾನೆ ಭಗವಂತ. ಆತನ ಅಧಪತನ ನಿಶ್ಚಿತ. So once the intellect is clouded due to anger, due to depression, due to the tension that your desire is not fulfilled, you become totally disillusioned, totally depressed. And due to anger, the mind, intellect, everything is clouded and you can't take proper decision and you end up with a depressed state of mind all the time. You become a fit case for the mental psychiatric treatment. That is how it happens in most of the cases. Too much of urge, too much of desire. That is what he say, Acharya calls Vishayanu Chintaya. Vishaya means, you know, lot of desires sprouting in the mind. So, such desires, they sprout your ego back. You know, they whatever ego you thought you have controlled by sadhana, by meditation, by japa, one fine day it will go away. It is the experience of most of the sadhakas, most of the spiritual aspirants. They say like that. I was doing meditation so peacefully all these days. My mind was so calm and quiet all these days. Suddenly, nowadays, for the last few days, in the last 1 month, in the last 1 week, suddenly I have stopped doing any of these things. My mind refuses to do any sadhana. My mind refuses to do meditation or japa or whatever it is. Somehow I have become like a zombie. I don't know what to do. I have become totally inactive. I have become totally lazy. I don't want meditation or this sadhana at all. I have no interest in that. So the interest has dried up. So these things, you know, lot of spiritual aspirants say is their experience. Not for all, but some of them, they come and say like that. All Mahatmans here, they say one thing. When there is such delusion clouding the intellect and the mind, it is coming as an obstacle in the way of sadhana. It is, you know, becoming an actual fundamental block in our mind. When the mind is totally in a desire condition, when it is under samvas sthiti, what is to be done? All Mahatmans normally, they are unanimous in advising their disciples, their devotees, that the best refuge during such circumstances, the best way to control and uplift yourself, best way to protect yourself is Bhagavan Namasmarana. Catch hold of the lotus feet of God. In the mind, think of the God. Have a continuous dialogue, monologue with the God. In fact, our Gurudev has mentioned this point in his autobiography, Thank You, Search for Truth. Especially in the last chapter, if you go deeper into that, he has given subtle hints. Our Gurudev himself says in one or two lines only, very subtle indication that with all the sadhana, by the grace of the Guru I was doing, I was almost reaching the final stage of self-realization, Atma Sakshatkara, but still at times, the sensuous feelings, Vishaya Sukha, Vasanas, the tendencies, they used to attack my mind. They used to hammer my mind. They used to create a lot of tension in the mind. And my mind used to run behind those sensuous objects in life. Our Gurudev has written. I am just, you know, elaborating what he meant. Then he says, during such circumstances, the only refuge for me was Lord Rama. So I used to control myself, bow down mentally at the lotus feet of Rama, Lord Rama, my Ishta Devata, and always pray, I beseech, I used to beg him to lift me from this cauldron of Maya, wherein I am being sucked into the mundane life activities and desires. So I always used to pray fervently, and ultimately God came to my rescue. That's what he mentions, our Gurudev mentions. So it is nothing wrong. So how to control ourselves when it is not possible by ourselves? The only refuge is I had to pray. I have to pray my Sadguru or Lord or Ishtadevata to help me to come out of this ahankara, to come out of this, the web of desires, this vasanas, tendencies, instincts. Because, you know, the thoughts will come. You can't control the thoughts. Thoughts will come when you sit, especially for meditation or japa. Automatically, more and more and more, there will be heavy influx of so much of unwanted thoughts, lustful thoughts, sensuous thoughts, your desires, all will come there. One after another, they will attack your mind, especially to turn you off from the path of spirituality. Adhyatma sadhane kathiya alugina hagi ente gurugalu yavagalu helutta idru yake endre. ಸಾಧನಾ ಮಾರ್ಗದಲ್ಲಿ ಎಲ್ಲೂ ಇಲ್ಲದಂತಹ ಮನಸ್ಸಿನ ಆಸೆಗಳು ನಮ್ಮ ಸುಪ್ತ ಮನಸ್ಸಲ್ಲಿ ಅಡಗಿರತಕ್ಕಂತಹ ವಾಸನಾ ಬೀಜಗಳು ಮತ್ತೆ ಮತ್ತೆ ಉತ್ಪತ್ತಿಯಾಗಿ ಆ ವಾಸನೆಗಳು ಬಲವಾಗ್ತಾ 108 ರೀತಿಯ ಬಯಕೆಗಳನ್ನು ಆಸೆಗಳನ್ನ ಮನಸ್ಸಲ್ಲಿ ತೋರ್ತಾ ಹೋಗುತ್ತದೆ, ತೋರಿಸ್ತಾ ಹೋಗುತ್ತದೆ. ಒಂದಾದ್ಮೇಲೆ ಆಸೆಗಳು ಬರ್ತಾ ಹೋಗುತ್ತೆ. ಅದರಲ್ಲೂ ಮುಖ್ಯವಾಗಿ ಸಾಧನಾ ಸಮಯದಲ್ಲಿ, ಧ್ಯಾನದ ಸಮಯದಲ್ಲಿ, ಅಥವಾ ಜಪ ಮಾಡುವ ಸಮಯದಲ್ಲಿ, ಅಥವಾ ಭಗವನ್ನಾಮ ಸ್ಮರಣೆ ಕೀರ್ತನ ಸಮಯದಲ್ಲಿ, ಅಥವಾ ಭಗವತ್ ಪೂಜಾ ಕೈಂಕರ್ಯದ ಸಮಯದಲ್ಲಿ ಈ ರೀತಿ ಕೂತಾಗ ಮನಸ್ಸಲ್ಲಿ ನೂರಾರು ಸಾವಿರಾರು ಸಾವಿರಾರು ಆಲೋಚನೆ ನಿಮ್ಮನ್ನ ಆಧ್ಯಾತ್ಮ ಪದದಲ್ಲಿ ಮುಂದೆ ಹೋಗೋದಕ್ಕೆ ಬಿಡದ ಹಾಗೆ ಮಾಡಿರ್ತಕ್ಕಂತಹ ಮಾಯೆಯ ವ್ಯವಸ್ಥೆ ಇದು. ಆ ಮಾಯೆಯ ವಿಕ್ಷೇಪ ಶಕ್ತಿ ಇದೆಯಲ್ಲ, ಅಷ್ಟು ಬಲವಾಗಿ ನಿಮ್ಮನ್ನ ನಮ್ಮನ್ನು ಹಿಡ್ಕೊಂಡಿದೆಯಲ್ಲ, ಆ ಮಾಯೆಯ ವಿಕ್ಷೇಪ ಶಕ್ತಿಯ ಪ್ರಭಾವ. ದಿ ವಿಕ್ಷೇಪ ಶಕ್ತಿ ಆಫ್ ಮಾಯ ಆಲ್ವೇಸ್ ಟ್ರೈಸ್ ಟು ಸೀ ದಟ್ ಯು ಡೋಂಟ್ ಎಂಟರ್ ಡೀಪ್ ಇನ್ ಟು ದಿ ಸ್ಪಿರಿಚುವಲ್ ಪಾತ್, ಪಾತ್ ಆಫ್ ಸಾಧನ. ದಟ್ ಯೋಗ ಮಾಯ, ದಟ್ ಅವ್ಯಕ್ತ ಪರಮೇಶ ಶಕ್ತಿ, ಆಸ್ ಆಚಾರ್ಯ ಅರ್ಲಿಯರ್ ಹ್ಯಾಡ್ ಕಾಲ್ಡ್, ಇಟ್ ವಿಲ್ ಸೀ ದಟ್ ಇಟ್ ವಿಲ್ ಟ್ರೈ ಟು ಡಿಸ್ಟ್ರಾಕ್ಟ್ ಯು ಫ್ರಮ್ ಯುವರ್ ಮೋಡ್ ಆಫ್ ಸಾಧನ, ಫ್ರಮ್ ದಿ ಪಾತ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ಸಾಧನ, ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಇಟ್ ವಿಲ್ ಪುಷ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಪುಷ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಪುಷ್ ಆಲ್ ಸಾರ್ಟ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಡಿಸೈರ್ಸ್, ಲಸ್ಟ್ಫುಲ್ ಡಿಸೈರ್ಸ್, ಸೆನ್ಸುವಸ್ ಡಿಸೈರ್ಸ್, ಈ ಸಡನ್ಲಿ ಥಾಟ್ ಆಫ್ಟರ್ ಥಾಟ್, ಲೈಕ್ ಎ ವೇವ್ ಆಫ್ಟರ್ ವೇವ್, ದೆ ಸ್ಟಾರ್ಟ್ ಪೋರಿಂಗ್ ಇನ್ ಟು ಯುವರ್ ಮೈಂಡ್, ಸ್ಪೆಷಲಿ ಡ್ಯೂರಿಂಗ್ ದಿ ಪೀರಿಯಡ್ ಆಫ್ ಸಾಧನ. ಸೊ ವಾಟ್ ಟು ಡೂ ದೆನ್? ಆಲ್ ದೀಸ್ ಥಿಂಗ್ಸ್ ವಿಲ್ ಫರ್ದರ್ ಬ್ಲೋಟ್ ಯುವರ್ ಈಗೋ, ಯುವರ್ ಈಗೋ ವಿಲ್ ಕಮ್ ಬ್ಯಾಕ್, ಇಟ್ ವಿಲ್ ಟೇಕ್ ಬ್ಯಾಕ್ ಇಟ್ಸ್ ಲೈಫ್. ಯು ಥಾಟ್ ದಟ್ ಯು ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಸಪ್ರೆಸ್ಡ್ ಯುವರ್ ಈಗೋ, ಯು ಥಾಟ್ ದಟ್ ಯು ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಕಿಲ್ಡ್ ಯುವರ್ ಈಗೋ, ನೋ, ಇಟ್ ವಿಲ್ ಕಮ್ ಬ್ಯಾಕ್. ದಟ್ಸ್ ವಾಟ್ ಆಚಾರ್ಯ ಸೇಸ್ ಇನ್ ದಿ ಶ್ಲೋಕ. ದೇಹಾತ್ಮನಾ ಸಂಸ್ಥಿತ ಏವ ಕಾಮೇ ವಿಲಕ್ಷಣ ಕಾಮಯಿತ ಕಥಂ ಸ್ಯಾತ್ ಅಥೋರ್ಥ ಸಂಧಾನ ಪರತ್ವಮೇವ ಭೇದ ಪ್ರಸಕ್ತ್ಯ ಭವಬಂದ ಹೇತು. ದೇಹಾತ್ಮನಾ ಸಂಸ್ಥಿತ ಏವ ಕಾಮೇ ವಿಲಕ್ಷಣ ಕಾಮಯಿತ ಕಥಂ ಸ್ಯಾತ್ ಅತಃ ಅರ್ಥ ಅರ್ಥ ಸಂಧಾನ ಪರತ್ವಮೇವ ಭೇದ ಪ್ರಸಕ್ತಿಯ ಭವಬಂಧ ಹೇತು. ನೌ ಆಚಾರ್ಯ ಡಿಸ್ಟಿಂಗ್ವಿಷಸ್ ಟೂ ಥಿಂಗ್ಸ್ ವೆರಿ ಕ್ಲಿಯರ್ಲಿ ಫಾರ್ ಅವರ್ ಸೇ ಇನ್ ದಿ ಶ್ಲೋಕ. ಈ ಡಿಸ್ಟಿಂಗ್ವಿಷಸ್ ಟೂ ಥಿಂಗ್ಸ್, ಈ ಡಿಫೈನ್ಸ್ ಹೂ ಇಸ್ ಅ ಕಾಮಿ, ಹೂ ಇಸ್ ಅ ಕಾಮಿ, who is kami and who is akami. ಈ ಶ್ಲೋಕದಲ್ಲಿ ಕಾಮಿ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಯಾರು, ಅಕಾಮಿ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಯಾರು ಅಂತ ಹೇಳ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ ಆಚಾರ್ಯರು. ಅಕಾಮಿ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಕಾಮವಿಲ್ಲದವನು. ಕಾಮ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಎಲ್ಲ ರೀತಿಯ ಆಸೆಗಳು, ವಿಷಯ ಸುಖದ ಆಸೆಗಳು ಮನಸ್ಸಲ್ಲಿ ಉತ್ಪತ್ತಿ ಆಗ್ತಾ ಇರುತ್ತಲ್ಲ, ಅದು ಬೇಕು ಇದು ಬೇಕು ಅಂತ, ಇದನ್ನು ಅನುಭವಿಸ್ಬೇಕು, ಅದನ್ನು ನೋಡಬೇಕು, ಇದನ್ನು ಮುಟ್ಟಬೇಕು, ಇದನ್ನು ಮೂಸಿ ನೋಡಬೇಕು, ಈ ರುಚಿಯನ್ನು ನಾನು ಸೇವಿಸಬೇಕು ಅನ್ನೋ ಎಲ್ಲ ರೀತಿಯ ಆಸೆಗಳು. ಅದರಲ್ಲೂ ಮುಖ್ಯವಾಗಿ ಇಲ್ಲಿ ವಿರುದ್ಧ ಲಿಂಗದ ಜೊತೆಗೆ ಉಂಟಾಗತಕ್ಕಂತಹ ಆಕರ್ಷಣೆ, ಲೈಂಗಿಕ ಆಕರ್ಷಣೆ, ಅದೂ ಸಹ ಕಾಮವೇ. ಈ ರೀತಿ ಎಲ್ಲ ರೀತಿಯ ಆಸೆಗಳು ಮನಸ್ಸಲ್ಲಿ ನುಗ್ಗಿ ಬರ್ತಾ ಇದ್ರೆ ಅಂತಹ ವ್ಯಕ್ತಿ ಕಾಮಿ. ನಮ್ಮ ಗುರುದೇವರು ಹೇಳ್ತಾ ಇದ್ರು ಕಾಮಕಾಮಿ ಅಂತ, ಅದನ್ನೇ ಮತ್ತೆ ಸ್ಪಷ್ಟವಾಗಿ ಹೇಳ್ತಾ ಇದ್ರು. ಸಾಮಾನ್ಯವಾಗಿ ಎಲ್ಲರೂ ಕಾಮಿಗಳೇ, ಯಾಕಂದ್ರೆ ಆಸೆ ಇಲ್ಲದ ವ್ಯಕ್ತಿಯೇ ಇಲ್ಲ. ಮನಸ್ಸಲ್ಲಿ ಆಸೆಗಳು ನುಗ್ಗಿ ಬರ್ತಾ ಇರುತ್ತದೆ. ಅಕಾಮಿ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಯಾರು? ಇದನ್ನು ಉಪನಿಷತ್ಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಮತ್ತೆ ಮತ್ತೆ ಬೇರೆ ಬೇರೆ ಶಬ್ದಗಳನ್ನು ಉಪಯೋಗಿಸಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಅಕಾಮಿ ಅಂತಂದ್ರೆ ಆಪ್ತಕಾಮ ಅಂದ್ರು ಅದೇ ಅರ್ಥ, ಆತ್ಮಕಾಮ ಅಂದ್ರು ಅದೇ ಅರ್ಥ. ಅಕಾಮಿ, ಆಪ್ತಕಾಮಿ, ಆತ್ಮಕಾಮಿ ಎಲ್ಲವೂ ಒಂದೇ ಅರ್ಥ, ಆಸೆಗಳು ಇಲ್ಲದೆ ಇರತಕ್ಕಂಥವನು ಅಕಾಮಿ ಅಂದ್ರೆ. ಆಪ್ತಕಾಮಿ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ತನ್ನಲ್ಲಿಯೇ, ತನ್ನ ಸ್ವಂತ ನಿಜರೂಪ ಏನಿದೆಯೋ ಅಲ್ಲಿಯೇ ತೃಪ್ತನಾಗಿ ತನ್ನ ಆತ್ಮಾನುಸಂಧಾನದಲ್ಲೇ ಇರತಕ್ಕಂಥವನು ಅಂತ ಅರ್ಥ. ಆತ್ಮಗಾಮಿ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಆತ್ಮನನ್ನು ಅರಿತುಕೊಂಡು ಆತ್ಮನಲ್ಲೇ ರಮಿಸ್ತಾ ಇರೋನು ಅಂತಲೂ ಅರ್ಥ. ಹೀಗೆ ಕಾಮಿಯಾದವನಿಗೆ ಏನಾಗುತ್ತೆ, ದೇಹವೇ ನಾನು ಅಂತ ಯಾರು ತಿಳ್ಕೊಂಡಿದ್ದಾರೆ, ಅಹಂ ಅಹಂ ನಾನು ಅಂದ್ರೆ ದೇಹ ಮನಸ್ಸು, ಆತ ಕಾಮಿ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ ಆಚಾರ್ಯ. ಇದು ನಾನು ದೇಹನೇ ಅಲ್ಲ ಅಂತ ಅನುಭವಕ್ಕೆ ಬಂದಿರೋವನು ಕಾಮಿ ಆಗ್ಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಸಾಧ್ಯ ಇಲ್ಲ. ಅವನಿಗೆ ಹೇಗೆ ಸಾಧ್ಯ, ಅವನಿಗೆ ಯಾವ ಆಸೆ ಇದೆ? ಅಕಾಮಿಗೆ ಯಾವ ಆಸೆ ಇಲ್ಲ, ಕಾಮಿಗೆ ಆಸೆಗಳಿದೆ. ಆದ್ದರಿಂದ ಮನಸ್ಸಿನಲ್ಲಿ ವಿಷಯ ಚಿಂತನೆಗಳನ್ನ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಅವಕಾಶ ಕೊಡ್ತಾ ಅದರಿಂದ ಸಂಸಾರ ಬಂಧನ ಉಂಟಾಗುತ್ತದೆ ಆಚಾರ್ಯ ನಿಷ್ಕರ್ಷ. ಅಥೋ ಅರ್ಥಸಂಧಾನ ಪರತ್ವಮೇವ ಭೇದ ಪ್ರಸಕ್ತಿಯ ಭವಬಂಧ ಹೇತು. ದೇಹಾತ್ಮನಾ ಸಂಸ್ಥಿತ ಏವ ಕಾಮಿ. ದ ವನ್ ಹೂ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ಐಡೆಂಟಿಫೈಡ್ ವಿತ್ ಬಾಡಿ ಮೈಂಡ್ ಕಾಂಪ್ಲೆಕ್ಸ್ ಆಚಾರ್ಯ ಕಾಲ್ಸ್ ಹಿಮ್ ಎಸ್ ಕಾಮಿ. ದ ವನ್ ಹೂ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ಗಾಟ್ ಅರ್ಜಸ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಡಿಸೈರ್ಸ್ ಸೆನ್ಸುವಸ್ ಡಿಸೈರ್ಸ್ ಆಲ್ ಟೈಪ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಡಿಸೈರ್ಸ್ ಸ್ಪ್ರೌಟ್ ಇನ್ ಇಸ್ ಮೈಂಡ್. ಯು ವಾಂಟ್ ಟು ಪೊಸೆಸ್, you want to enjoy the life. So all sorts of desires when they arise, and a person, he thinks that he is the body mind complex, such a person is called kami according to acharya. Dehatmana samsthita eva kami vilakshana kamayita katam syat. Vilakshana, that word acharya is using here, vilakshana means the one who is the opposite to kami, that means akami. Aptakami or Atmaka. So one who is not a Kami means one who has not identified totally with his body-mind complex. One who has realized that he is Atmasuru. The one who knows his own nature. The one who knows his own reality. The one who has established himself in his own self. The one who has realized his own self. The one who is emancipated, in other words. The one who is realized master, in other words. Or the one who is a Brahmajnani, in other words. He is Vilakshana, Acharya says. He is Akami. No desires. All desires have been totally burnt out. Because his ego is totally burnt out. The ego is removed. He no more thinks that he is the body-mind complex. So there are no more desires sprouting in the mind that I want to do this, I want to do that, I want to possess this, I want to have this, I want to enjoy in this way. All such desires have vanished. So such a person is akami, without desires. So he cannot be kami. Vilakshana kamayita katham syat acharya. Ataha arthanusandhana paratvameva heda prasakya bhavabandha hetu. He concludes in this shloka. Which is responsible, bhavabandha hetu, which is responsible for samsara to continue, which is bhavabandha hetu. Hetu means responsible. Which is responsible for you to continue birth after birth in this line, in this cycle. You are born, you live, you try to enjoy, you suffer in fulfilling all your desires. You think that you are the body, you are the sharirabhimana, you develop from the birth till death, you develop that complexity, all the vasanas are there. Your ego becomes strong and strong and strong, and ultimately one fine day you will die. Again you are reborn with another name, with another body, presumably thinking that you get a human birth only. No guarantee. Indian Sanatana Dharma in the Vedanta is very clear. There is no guarantee that after the death you are reborn 100% as a human being only. No guarantee at all. This is what Vedanta calls transmigration of the soul. That is the English word. That means no guarantee that you are reborn as, again, human being. You may be reborn as an animal. Say, for example, cow or a buffalo or a elephant or even a dog or even a pig or a bird or a reptile like snake, like lizard, or even varieties of insects or the worms which live in the muddy water, slushy water, the filthy water. So anything. You may be born, depending on your karmas, depending on the actions you have performed in this birth, all horrendous, heinous actions you have performed. That will decide what birth you will get next. Whether you are born as a human being or not, but you will be born, definite. Till a realization occurs, you are entangled in the cycle of birth and death, permanent, without any escape. It's almost impossible to escape. The only key to escape is realization. You remember, some small digression here. Our Gurudev was fond of small, very interesting anecdotes he used to say personally to me also, and he has told others also. You know, there is a story in the Ramayana, the great epic Ramayana story. You remember after Rama Pattabhisheka, return of Rama along with Sita back to Ayodhya, and he's crowned as a king, and then Lakshmana was told to see that if anybody has something to say, if he is offended in my kingdom, let him push the bell which is strung on the main gate of the palace. And Lakshmana's duty is to bring such a person to the Rama's darbar, and the person will narrate what has happened to him. Anybody has done anything wrong to him, immediately it will be rectified. That was the order given to Lakshmana by Rama himself. Then one fine day, you remember, I think most of you know the story. The bell rings when the sabha, when the royal sabha was going on, Lord Rama was sitting on the throne, and then the bell sound rings and Lakshmana goes running, and then he brings or comes back to the royal palace where attendants are there. A dog comes in. The dog is bleeding on the head. There is somebody has hit the dog, it is bleeding. And Rama asks, how is it a dog has come? And the dog says, yes, I was the dog which rang the bell. I need justice. I want justice. I have been wrong. When I was outside, a monk, a sannyasi with a food was coming. I dashed to have some food because I was not getting food for the last 1 week or 4 days or 5 days. I was very, very, very hungry. So I dashed my instinctive nature towards the food. And that monk became very angry. And with his lathi, with his danda, he hit me so hard on the head. See, it is bleeding. So I want the monk to be punished. The dog says. Everybody was stunned. Then Rama looks at the dog and he orders the monk also to come, and the monk also comes into the royal palace, and then the monk accepts. He says, I was carrying the food in my bag. The dog all the way came down and then started, you know, attacking my bag. So I became angry. So I hit the dog. So it's my mistake. I accept my mistake. I'm telling you the truth. Then what to do? What punishment to the monk for hitting the dog? Then Lord Rama asks the dog itself. Now the monk has accepted his mistake. You have been offended. you need justice. In this court of Rama, justice shall prevail. That is my promise to the kingdom, to the whole mankind. Tell me. He addresses the doctor. He says, tell me, what punishment you want me to give to this monk for hitting you hard on your head? Then the dog says, Rajan, if you're asking me what punishment this monk should get, you make him the pontiff, pithadipati of a famous mutt here in this town of Kalinjara, where a huge temple is there. Let him become the head of the temple and the pitham also. Everybody was stunned. Rama was stunned. Lakshmana was stunned. Then smilingly, Lord Rama asks, see, you have been offended. So we thought the monk should be punished. So, but when we gave you a chance, instead of punishing him, you are asking him to be made head of a huge mutt, pitham, in charge of that, where a huge temple is there, in charge of the temple also. What is this? Something surprising. Can you explain why you are saying like that? Then the dog says to Lord Bhagavan, in my previous birth, I was a human being. I was in charge of that mutt, the famous pitham, where the famous temple is there. I was in charge of the pitham and the temple both. I was a supreme authority. A lot of people were under me working. I was a big boss there. And due to my desires, due to my urges, which I could not control, I gradually stole the property of the mutt or the pitham and the ornaments of the deity in the temple without anybody's knowledge. I stacked them because I had the desire to possess all these things. So in other words, I really became a thief. I stole without anybody's knowledge. So for this heinous crime, this karma, bad karma I committed in that life, immediately my previous life, God has given me punishment in the form of this law of karma, according to law of karma. Now I am born as dog. In this birth, immediately I am born as a dog. But due to my good fortune, I remembered my previous birth. So I want you to put this monk in charge of that pitham and that mutt, that temple, so that he will be later follow the same thing what I did, and then in his next birth, he will become a dog. So that was a beautiful point, small sub-story in Ramayana. Our Gurudev was humorously, he was narrating that, to narrate, to give example to law of karma, how karma will lead you to the next life. Not necessarily you are born as a human. You may be born as a pig. You may be born as a dog. You may be born as a snake. You may be born as a rat. You may be born as an ant or an insect or a cockroach. Gurudev smilingly used to say this. It all depends on the karma you perform in this birth also. Plus, the baggage you have carried from the previous birth, Sanchita Karma. All put together, law of karma, nobody knows. It is all immutable, interconnecting, secret and sacred law of karma will decide your future birth, what you should be. That is how Gurudev used to say. So here, Vilakshana Kamayita Katham Syat. So the one who has realized Vilakshana Kamayita Katham Syat Acharya. How can he desire anything? Where is the lust? His ahankara, ego, destroyed. His lust totally gone, destroyed. His mind has become totally pure. purest of the pure, Vishuddha Sattva, it has lost Tamoguna and Rajoguna. In that sense, there is Manonasha. And all the desires he has lost. He is simply living out the prarabdha of the physical body. As long as the body has to live, he is living. He is becoming a witness to himself. So what does he desire? He desires nothing. He wants nothing. So he is vilakshana, he is aptakami, he is akami, a non-desiring person. He is a realized person. What does he desire? Nothing at all. So here, Chandrasekhar Bharati Mahaswami, while explaining the shloka, now he extensively quotes the shloka of Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, where Yajnavalkya, the sage, is giving Upadesha to Maitri. So, in that Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, there is a famous mantra or vachana is there. Mahamantra is there. It says, Atmanam chet vijaniyat ayamasmiti purushaha kimachan kasya kamaya shariram anusanjvaret. Brihadaranyaka Upanishad says, Atmanam chet vijaniyat ayamasmiti purushaha kimachan kasya kamaya shariram anusanjvaret. Kimachan kasya kamaya shariram anusanjvaret. Atmanam vijaniyat chet ayam asmiti purushaha. So when the person realizes that he is the Atmasurupa himself, he is no more the body, he is no more physical body, he is no more sthula sharira, he is no more sukshma sharira, he is no more manomaya kosha, he is no more pranamaya kosha, he is no more vijnanamaya kosha, he is no more anandamaya kosha. He is above all these koshas. Within that, he is that supreme. He is that supreme consciousness or awareness or that absolute. I am that only. So once he has realized, once he knows, Atmanam chet vijaniyat ayam asmi iti purusha. Once he knows, once he realizes, kimichan kasya kamaya shariram anusanjvare. So, kimichan kasya kamaya shariram anusanjvare. The Upanishad says, such a person, what more he wants? For whose benefit? Yav prayojanak oskara, yari oskara, nano paramatma swarupa, brahma swarupave agiddene, atma swarupane agiddene anta anubhavakke bandantavanu, yav prayojanakkagi ee aasegalanna yenadru bayistane athava ee shariirad bagge abhimana padtane anta artha. Aatana ella bayikegalu abhimanagalu pato irutte kevala atmanishtanagi ಸದಾ ಸರ್ವದಾ ಸರ್ವಕಾಲದಲ್ಲಿ ಆತ್ಮನಿಷ್ಠನಾಗಿ ಆನಂದ ರಸರೂಪದಲ್ಲಿ ಸರ್ವಾತ್ಮ ಭಾವದಲ್ಲಿ ಆತ್ಮರತಿಯಲ್ಲೇ ಮುಳುಗಿರುತ್ತಾನೆ ಅಂತ ಅರ್ಥ. ಏನನ್ನೂ ಬಯಸದೇ ಇರತಕ್ಕಂತಹ ಸ್ಥಿತಿ ಅಂತಹವನು ಆಪ್ತಕಾಮಿ, ಅಂತಹವನು ಬ್ರಹ್ಮಜ್ಞಾನಿ ಅನ್ನುವ ಅರ್ಥ ಇದೆ ಉಪನಿಷತ್ ಹೇಳಿ. ಇದನ್ನು ಮಹಾಸ್ವಾಮಿಗಳು ಈ ಶ್ಲೋಕಕ್ಕೆ ಕೊಟ್ಟಿರತಕ್ಕಂಥ ಉದಾಹರಣೆ. ಇನ್ನು ಮುಂದಿನ ಕೆಲವು ಶ್ಲೋಕಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಆಚಾರ್ಯರು ಇದನ್ನು ಮತ್ತೆ ವಿಶದವಾಗಿ ನಮಗೆ ಪದೇ ಪದೇ ಅರ್ಥ ಆಗಬೇಕಲ್ಲ, ಅರ್ಥ ಆಗಬೇಕು ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಬೇಕಲ್ಲ. ಹಾಗಾಗಿ ಇನ್ನು ಮುಂದಿನ ಶ್ಲೋಕಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಮೂರು ವಿಚಾರಗಳನ್ನು ತಿಳಿಸ್ಕೊಳ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ. ಸರಿಯಾಗಿ ಗಮನ ಇಟ್ಟು ತಾವು ಅನುಸರಿಸಬೇಕು. ಮೂರು ಪ್ರಮುಖವಾದ ವಿಷಯಗಳನ್ನು ಹೇಳ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ ಮುಂದಿನ ಕೆಲವು ಶ್ಲೋಕಗಳಲ್ಲಿ. ಯಾವುದು? ಒಂದು ವಾಸನೆಗಳು, ಎರಡನೇದು ವಿಷಯ ಚಿಂತನೆ ಅಂದರೆ ಆಸೆಗಳು, ಬಯಕೆಗಳು, ಕಾಮೋತ್ಪತ್ತಿ, ರಾಗ, ವಿಷಯ ಚಿಂತನೆಗಳು. ಮೂರನೆಯದು ಕರ್ಮ, ನಾವು ಮಾಡ್ತಕ್ಕಂತಹ ಕಾರ್ಯಗಳು. ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಮೂರು ವಿಷಯಗಳನ್ನು ತಗೊಂಡು ಹೇಳ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ, ಕರ್ಮ, ವಿಷಯ ಚಿಂತನೆ ಮತ್ತು ವಾಸನೆ. ವಾಸನೆ ಅನ್ನೋದಕ್ಕೆ ವೇದಾಂತದಲ್ಲಿ ಇನ್ನೊಂದು ಶಬ್ದ ಇದೆ, ಸಂಸ್ಕಾರ. ಕೆಲವು ಅರ್ಥದಲ್ಲಿ ಸಂಸ್ಕಾರ ಮತ್ತು ವಾಸನೆ ಎರಡು ಒಂದೇ ಅನ್ನೋ ಸಮಾನಾಂತರದಲ್ಲಿ ಬಳಸಿದ್ದು ಉಂಟು. ಅವುಗಳ ಮಧ್ಯೆ ಸೂಕ್ಷ್ಮವಾದ ಒಂದು ವಿವರಣೆ ಕೊಡಬೇಕು ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಮಟ್ಟಿಗೆ ಭೇದ ಇದೆ ಅನ್ನೋದು ಕೆಲವು ಕಡೆ ಬರುತ್ತೆ, ಸಂದರ್ಭಾನುಸಾರ ತಗೊಳ್ಬೇಕಾಗುತ್ತೆ. ಒಟ್ಟಿನಲ್ಲಿ ಸಂಸ್ಕಾರ ಮತ್ತು ವಾಸನೆ ಎರಡು ಹೆಚ್ಚು ಕಡಿಮೆ ಒಂದೇ ಅರ್ಥ. ವಿಶದವಾಗಿ ಮತ್ತೆ ಒಳಗೆ ಬಿಡಿಸಿ ಹೇಳಬೇಕು ಅಂತಂದ್ರೆ ಮುಖ್ಯವಾದ ಇವುಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಇರ್ತಕ್ಕಂಥ ಭೇದ ಏನು ಅಂತಂದ್ರೆ, ಸಂಸ್ಕಾರಗಳು ಅಂತಂದ್ರೆ ಸಾಮಾನ್ಯವಾಗಿ ಒಳ್ಳೆಯ ಯೋಚನೆಗಳು, ಒಳ್ಳೆಯ ಕಾರ್ಯ ಪ್ರವೃತ್ತಿಯನ್ನು ಬೆಳೆಸ್ತಕ್ಕಂತಹ ಸತ್ವಗುಣ ಪ್ರಧಾರಿತ ಮನಸ್ಸಿನ ವೃತ್ತಿಗಳು ಸಂಸ್ಕಾರ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳ್ಬೋದು. ಹಿಂದಿನ ಜನ್ಮಗಳಿಂದ ಬಂದಿರತಕ್ಕಂಥದ್ದು ಒಳ್ಳೆಯ ಆಲೋಚನೆಗಳು, ಒಳ್ಳೆಯ ಯೋಚನೆಗಳು, ಒಳ್ಳೆಯ ಬಯಕೆಗಳು, ಸತ್ವ ಪ್ರಧಾನ ಪ್ರೇರಿತವಾಗಿ ಹಿಂದಿನ ಜನ್ಮಗಳಿಂದ ಬಂದಿರತಕ್ಕಂಥದ್ದು, ಅದು ಸಕಾರಾತ್ಮಕ ತರಂಗಗಳಿಂದ ಕೂಡಿರತಕ್ಕಂಥದ್ದನ್ನು ಸಂಸ್ಕಾರ. ಅದು ಹುಟ್ಟಿನಿಂದ ಬಂದಿರತಕ್ಕಂಥದ್ದು ಸಕಾರಾತ್ಮಕ ಸತ್ವಗುಣ ಪ್ರಧಾರಿತ ಸಂಸ್ಕಾರ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳ್ಬೋದು. ವಾಸನೆ ಅನ್ನೋದನ್ನ ನಕಾರಾತ್ಮಕ ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಮಟ್ಟಿಗೆ ತಮೋಗುಣ ರಜೋಗುಣದ ಪ್ರಭಾವದಿಂದ ಹಿಂದಿನ ಜನ್ಮಗಳಿಂದ ಬಂದಿರತಕ್ಕಂತಹ ಕೆಲವು ಅಶುದ್ಧ ಮನಸ್ಸಿನ ವಾಸನೆಗಳನ್ನ ವಾಸನೆ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳ್ಬೋದು. ಅಶುದ್ಧ ಮನಸ್ಸಿನ ಸಂಸ್ಕಾರಗಳನ್ನ ವಾಸನೆ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳೋದಾದ್ರೆ, ಶುದ್ಧ ಮನಸ್ಸಿನ ವಿಷಯಗಳನ್ನ ಆಲೋಚನೆಗಳನ್ನ ಸಂಸ್ಕಾರ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳ್ಬೋದು. ಒಟ್ಟಿನಲ್ಲಿ ಸಾಮಾನ್ಯವಾಗಿ ಸಂಸ್ಕಾರ ವಾಸನೆ ಎರಡು ಒಂದೇ ಅನ್ನೋ ಲೆಕ್ಕದಲ್ಲಿ ಎಷ್ಟೋ ಕಡೆ ಸಂದರ್ಭಕ್ಕೆ ಅನುಕೂಲವಾಗಿ ವೇದಾಂತದಲ್ಲಿ ಬಳಸಿದ್ದು ಉಂಟು. ಸೊ ಇನ್ ನೆಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ ಸೆಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಶ್ಲೋಕಾಸ್ ಆಚಾರ್ಯ ಟೇಕ್ಸ್ ಅಪ್ ತ್ರೀ ಎಕ್ಸಾಂಪಲ್ಸ್. ಇಟ್ ಡೀಲ್ಸ್ ವಿತ್ ದಟ್. ಒನ್ ಇಸ್ ಕರ್ಮ, ಆಕ್ಷನ್. ಅನದರ್ ಇಸ್ ವಾಸನ. ಥರ್ಡ್ ಒನ್ ಇಸ್ ವಿಷಯ ಚಿಂತನ ಮೀನ್ಸ್ ದಿ ಆಲ್ವೇಸ್ ದಿಸೈರ್ಸ್ ಒನ್ ಆಫ್ಟರ್ ಆಲ್ ಟೈಪ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಡಿಸೈರ್ಸ್, ನೆಗೆಟಿವ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಪಾಸಿಟಿವ್ ಡಿಸೈರ್ಸ್. Desires, kama. Now, vasana means, as I was telling just, there are two words in Vedanta. Vasana and samskara, both almost same. They are used in so many contexts as with the same meaning. Vasana means some of the negative instincts or tendencies we carry from the previous path, which are propelled by mainly tamoguna and rajoguna. All the bad tendencies, negative tendencies, instincts we carry, that will make you to think in a particular way. So those instincts, negative, mainly they are called vasanas. They have come from ashuddhamans. So they are almost, not pure. We can say impure tendencies. The pure tendencies, mainly influenced by sattvaguna from the previous birth. From the previous births, the pure tendencies, the pure instincts, they are called samskaras with shuddhamanas. So samskaras lead to your sudden actions, certain desires in the positive way in the life. Vasanas result in negative. The person with more impure vasanas, he will go down in the life. He will be a sort of a person not wanted, a person who is discarded, a person who is kept aloof, away from dignified. So people with good samskaras, they are always preferred. People want to be with them. People want to be in their association because they are carrying positive vibrations. So the positive vibrations which lead to positive thoughts, they are called samskaras. But anyway, vasana, samskara, in most of the way, they intermingle with the same. You can consider as vasana or samskara. So Acharya is taking now in the next set of shlokas, these three things. One is karma, the action, how they are influenced. Other is the set of desires, vishaya chintana. And vasanas. So with this, the Guru Sankalpa closing today. Rama Jaya Rama Jaya Jaya Rama Sri Rama Jaya Rama Jaya Jaya Rama Sri Rama Jaya Rama Jaya Jaya Rama Sri Rama Jaya Rama Jaya Jaya Rama Hari Om. 310th shloka we have stopped today.
Hari Om, sir.
Hari Om.
Thank you so much. This is a beautiful story of the dog who came to Lord Rama's court. Amazing, amazing story.
That is in Valmiki Ramayana, written by Maharshi himself as a sub story.
What a way to seek justice.
Yeah, very interesting.
Hari Om, sir.
Hari Om. Hari Om.